Welcome to a special edition of DC Humanities. I am Marya McQuirter, the host. We're here at the 10th annual Hearts Day Conference sponsored by the Department of English at Howard University. Dr. Eleanor Traylor, Chair of the English Department, is a Humanities Council grant recipient in the amount of $1,500. She spoke with us about the history of the conference and the selection of Haki Madhubuti as this year's honoree. We are here with Dr. Eleanor Traylor, Chair of the English Department at Howard University. Hi, Dr. Traylor. Welcome to DC Humanities. Mwah. It's wonderful to see you. So this is the 10th year of the Hearts Day Conference.
Yes.
Talk to me about the founding of the conference.
Well, now this conference is about life and love and learning and teaching and scholarship, about all of the things that Howard University is about. It serves two purposes.
Okay.
It brings before our community, our students, writers who have globally represented this community and this university. And it serves to promote a professor who for 40 years taught here. He was the professor who was most instrumental in inaugurating the study of African American literature in the academy. His name is Sterling Brown,
yes.
A poet, a scholar, a teacher, and a progenitor of a generation and generations continuing of writers. All the writers that we honor here claim him as mentor and ancestor. The Department of English wishes to fully endow a distinguished chair in his name. We are almost there, but we need our entire community's support to do that. Now, the other goal that this conference serves is that it represents a goal of President Patrick Swiger in his strategic plan for the university to increase private support. Alumni and alumnae of the Department of English send in that support to help us fully fund this chair. Mm-hmm. Because of that, we have received grants from foundations like the Arthur Vining Davis Foundation, who see its importance. We hope that very soon, with the help of our constituent communities, this chair will be firmly and fully funded.
That's wonderful. That'd be a wonderful thing once it happens, because of course our audience knows how important Sterling Brown is.
That's right.
He's a native Washingtonian, and he
and the chair signals our traditions at Howard English, our unique mission to serve literatures developing in English after the diaspora, and that's what he stands for.
So talk to me about how you all came to the process of selecting Haki
Madhubuti. Oh, he's a natural. First of all, he claims Sterling Brown as his mentor, has dedicated many books to Mr. Brown, and Gwendolyn Brooks, senior late poet Gwendolyn Brooks, as well as an entirety of Howard University professoria. But Haki Madhubuti has exemplified that ancestry. He has produced 24 books of poetry, of social essays, of educational inquiry, of philosophical inquiry. He is celebrating the 30th anniversary of the press which he founded, Third World Press. He and his wife, Safisha, are co-founders of two fantastic independent schools in Chicago, Illinois, where they live, the pedagogies of those schools should be paradigms for all, because the outcome of them is that not one child is left behind. And those two schools are called the Institute for Positive Education and the New Concept School for Primary Grades. So for these and a thousand reasons, Haki is the celebrant of the 10th anniversary.
That's wonderful. I remember one of my first introductions to Haki Madhubuti's work was actually when he was Don L. Lee.
Yes, the Don L. Lee. Right. I call him Don Haki. That's right.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And I think, I mean, obviously he took on this name and in some ways a new persona as a response and as a part of the developing black arts movement.
That's exactly right.
In the
1960s. Of which he is a founding poet. And of course, the name Haki Madhubuti was awarded him. I know you'll speak with him, mm-hmm. and I'll let you tell him what that means.
Okay, I will do that. As I was saying also, is that one of my first introductions to him as a writer, as an author, was as the author of From Plan to Plan.
Oh, yes.
One of my mentors that shared that work with
oh,
me.
Oh, yeah.
Are there any particular books or poems or any of his particular writing that has particularly inspired you or any of your students?
Oh, indeed so. From Plan to Planet is one of them. And of course, the early poetry through the late from Think Black, Black Pride, Don't Cry, Scream, We Walk the Way of the New World, to Book of Life, From Plan to Planet, and all through to his most recent, Black Men, and Tough Notes, a healing concept, all of those.
Yeah,
and we weave them in. Of course, my students are thoroughly convinced of the role that the black arts movement has played in developing critical thought, which has come after it. And after all, Gwendolyn Brooks called Haki Madhubuti, said, he is at the hub of the new word way.
Mm, that's
pretty powerful. The new word way is what the black arts movement delivered. Mm-hmm.
That's pretty powerful. And I've read that Haki, that Gwendolyn Brooks was a mentor for Haki Madhubuti. And she lived in Chicago and I guess helped to mentor him.
Oh, yeah.
And actually she had a previous publisher and then after a certain time she only was published.
Yes, and they were
press.
Collaborators. And it was an illustration of how the now generation talks to the ancestor and the ancestor mm-hmm. talks back and both, you know, are modified. Haki is also the founder and director emeritus now, of the Gwendolyn Brooks Center for Research in Black Culture at Chicago State University.
Mm-hmm. It's wonderful.
They're close and wonderful, honored relationships. So many of those kinds of mentorships mm-hmm. exist, and those are the kinds of mentorships that we wish to emulate.
Yeah. Well, so Haki Madhubuti was the honoree for this year. Who have been some of your past honorees?
Sonia Sanchez was last year, before her, Amiri Baraka, before him, James Baldwin, posthumously. There's been Chinua Achebe, there's been Paul Marshall, there's been, of course, the Howard University Nobel writer, Toni Morrison, mm-hmm. and so on, Maya Angelou and the like.
Uh-huh. So he's in very good company.
Oh, absolutely. You know, we can go on with these forever, you know. Each one is a stunning representative of the new word way, as Haki would say, black.
So what is it that, in terms of the conference
and me
today,
too.
And of course you, Dr. Traylor, what are some of the goals that you have in terms of conference? I see that there are a number of students who are here, professors, scholars who've come from
well,
outside of the city.
This conference is the consummation, as I've said, of what we do here. And the students come to embrace that. We all come to embrace that in each other. The whole university participates in this conference.
Now, I do want to share with the audience how the Humanities Council was able to help you in terms of making
tremendously.
This conference happen.
The Humanities Council is making this moment happen. We are unable to afford media coverage. The council's grant to us enabled us to videotape this conference. I wish that we had been able to videotape all of them. Each one has been absolutely splendid in an outpouring of scholarship, an outpouring of creative writing, an outpouring of thought. And our students love it. Mm-hmm. Colleagues love it. I mean, as I say, it represents us. And the council's award to us this year has allowed us to share this conference with our community, those who are unable to attend, although the community pours in. I mean, we are just one. There is no separation between town and gown here.
Right, exactly. And how, I mean, there's a long, of course, history of Howard University's role in the development of this city.
That's
now,
right.
Now, are you all, I don't want to jump the gun, but are you all thinking about the conference next year and who you
this
might honoree?
This is the wrong day to ask. This is the wrong day to ask. Okay. This conference takes the calcium out of our teeth. So we are just so happy to produce this moment. We'll let you know about the next.
Okay. Well, we'll look forward to hearing that. Thank you so much, Dr. Traylor, again, for talking to us and sharing with us about the life and work of Haki and the conference over the past 10 years.
Thank you.
I am Marya McQuirter, host of DC Humanities, and we are here at the Howard University Blackburn Center in celebration of the 10th Annual Hearts Day Conference sponsored by the Department of English at Howard University. This year, they are honoring the life and work of Haki Madhubuti. We had the opportunity to speak with Haki Madhubuti about his commitment to art and scholarship over the past 40 years. We are here at the 10th Annual Hearts Day Conference with Haki Madhubuti, the honoree for this event. Dr. Madhubuti, it's wonderful to be able to speak with you.
Thank you very much.
First, we've been here since it started about 10 a.m., so for the last two or three hours, you've been hearing up to maybe a dozen or so people talk about your life and work. I just wanted to know, how does it feel to have people talk about what you've done for the last 40 years? Just what is it like to be honored today?
It is an honor, and kind of unexpected. Greatly appreciated. Quite humbling. But for young people to have an appreciation for not only my work, but Gwendolyn Brooks and Mitty Baraka and Sonia Sanchez and others who come out of that same movement, I'm very honored and really kind of almost tongue-tied in terms of how do you respond to something like that? It's very difficult to do that. But Dr. Traylor and her staff and faculty have done a very beautiful job. And to have this done in one's lifetime when one is still healthy and able to appreciate it and listen to the comments, both positive and critically negative, but critically positive in the sense, I appreciate it. It can only help me grow and continue to work.
Okay. Now, you did mention the students, and there has been this kind of energy in terms of the conference of this really being about celebrating your work, but also about speaking to the next generation.
Yeah.
So what is it about your work and also the work of the Black Arts Movement and what's happened since that you really hope that the students take away from this conference?
Well, the possibilities. I mean, when we emerged in the 60s, we were bold enough and in some ways conscious enough to not be denied the kind of reality we were trying to bring forth. And that reality had to do with self-definition, self-defense, building our own institutions, making a world for ourselves. And that kind of reality has not gone away. And so for the students here at Howard University and others, it is important for them to take this day and begin to, you know, define themselves and build upon what we have given as well as what preceded even my generation. That's why I'm here. I mean, if it wasn't for Langston Hughes, and Margaret Walk Alexander, and Claude McKay, and Robert Hayden, and Melvin Tolson, and many others, I wouldn't be here, you see. So it's important that they understand that, and that it's not about the competition between writers and artists, but it's how we complement one another, and how all of our voices have meaning and therefore are legitimate.
Now, one of the things I wanted, particularly since you have been doing this kind of work as a poet, as a scholar, as an activist, as heading up this publishing company, is it, and doing this work for the past 40 years or so, is it a challenge at all in terms of where you started, in terms of being Donnell Lee, and where you are in terms of Haki Madhubuti, in terms of people, because it seems like you've progressed, or not to say progressed, but changed from where you were in terms of Donnell Lee 40 or so years ago to today. I guess intellectually, is that a challenge in terms of getting people to kind of go with you on that journey of how you've changed over the years?
Well, the journey has been an awesome journey. And part of that journey is an actual journey in terms of traveling, not only in terms of just about every state in the United States, but you know, all throughout Africa, Asia, Europe, Central America, and so forth. And so it has been one, the immersion in not only my own culture in terms of Africa, but also the immersion in other cultures. That's how one grows and how one began to get a perspective, a world perspective or a global perspective. As far as other people learning from that, I would hope so. That most certainly I stand on the shoulders of El-Hajj Malik El-Shabazz, Malcolm X, and Margaret Burroughs and Charlie Burroughs, and Hort W. Fuller, Dudley Randall, Barbara Ann Sizemore, and of course, Gwendolyn Brooks. And so if I had not come from those persons, if I had not come through those persons, I may not be here today. And so we all grow as a result of the kind of communities that we become a part of. And these communities become defining for us in terms of our life work. And we have to find these what I call life-saving and life-developing communities if we are to grow. We're not singular in our existence. And so between them and then my own family and my wife, Dr. Safisha Madhubuti, and our children, then I become a better man as a result of all of that, you see. And you couple that with my own, you know, formal education and informal education. But more importantly, or just as important, this struggle that we're involved in. I think the Black Arts Movement, the Black Empowerment Movement, are coming out of the 60s and 70s. We changed the world, and changed the world for the better. And so I do not buy into the delusions of these privileged presidents who come into power and want to essentially belittle that movement, saying that it destroyed their children. Well, it may indeed destroy their children, but most certainly it brought a revelation and new direction for us as a people.
Thank you, Dean Thornton. With that, I'd like to bring the head of the English department, the woman behind the conference, our illustrious leader, Dr. Eleanor Traylor, to give the keynote address.
Honorees, officers of the university, dean of the college, conference coordinators, thank you for your love, distinguished presenters and panelists, and the distinguished professoria from all over the city and the country. I am looking at my colleague, Dr. Beverly Guy Sheftall from Spelman College. colleagues, students, friends, the Nora who named her mother the Gwendolyn, meaning senior poet Gwendolyn Brooks, beloved all. On behalf of the faculty and staff and students of the Department of English, I have the impossible task of thanking you for assuring that this annual tribute to the creative genius, the scholarly persistence, and the activistic resourcefulness of Black authors stands as a living legacy at our university. Gratitude is a strong virtue, but in this case, inadequate to express the large implication of your loyalty to this commemorative event, which encourages and renews the identity, purpose, and direction of scholarship, pedagogy, and activism realized as the mission of Howard University through all its areas of study, and not only political science. Identity, purpose, and direction are three of the most frequently used words in the theoretical and poetic volumes of our honoree, Professor Haki Madhubuti. In the universe of thought which he has inspired, these three words also account for his achievement on which this conference focuses inquiry. Fortunately, one example of that achievement, and likewise the achievement of Black poetry, is a language that honors you. The way you move to return this earth, as the poet has said, into the hands of human beings, as you walk the way of the new world. Just so, in response to our need, the poet gives us words to open our grateful hearts to you as he says, we are here, combat weary and willing now and singing fired energy and hope, imagining the inconceivable here, urgently seeking lost records, igniting possibilities, to recall the memory, to recall the tradition and meaning, to rename the bringer's genius in the arms of loving smiles among the care of the consciously certain, within the circle of the continued questioners, to remember them, ancestors all, as dark and talented, as gifted light, bringers of source, bringers of silence, bringers of remembrance. These lines, by which we also remember and honor our most recent ancestors, Tony Cade Bambara, Calvin Herndon, June Jordan, and Claudia Tate, are excerpted from a volume called Killing Memory, Seeking Ancestors, the 15th of the 24 published volumes of Professor Madubuti, not counting the number of books and journals he has edited, but he continually belies the count because he is writing all the time. And the next volume may appear in the bookstores this very afternoon. Killing Memory, Seeking Ancestors is not the first of his books to be dedicated to Howard University's venerable Professor Sterling Allen Brown, whose legacy of teaching, scholarship, community service, and creative genius is carried forth through the genius of writers like Haki Madhubuti, celebrant of the Hearts of Hearts Day 2003, the 10th annual tribute to African American writers initiated by the Department of English at Howard University. This tribute also strengthens the effort of the department to endow fully a distinguished chair in honor of Professor Brown, who with his colleagues at Howard and Morgan State University and wider over 63 years ago inspired, if not inaugurated, the study of Black literature in the academy. An insistence upon the identity of their literary and philosophic ancestry. One shared characteristic of theoristic poets like Don L. Lee becoming Haki Madhubuti and beginning publication in the 1960s is one performance indicator defining what the herald voice of theorist Larry Neal enunciated as the Black Arts Movement. Yet more than redeeming and historicizing their forebears, Black arts writers located new constellations through the discourses and forms which they were answering, renovating, and even more ascending to inscribe on the horizon of thought and art. So for Don Haki, no reference to the Corleone family, just my thought and familiar. Sterling Brown not only exemplifies, as he says, the highest tradition of Black oral communication combined with scholarly research, he also becomes a summoner to whom the poet responds. In Killing Memory, Seeking Ancestors, we hear a poem in which voice and address, which in voice and address, in compositional strategy, and in identity, purpose, and direction, wakes to memory an infrequently quoted poem of Sterling Brown. The Brown poem introduces a poetic conversation which, by its intensity among the generation of writers blooming in the 1960s, further characterizes Black arts writing. Sterling Brown's poem entitled Memo for the Race Orators reminds speakers who assess race achievement by the liberational words and deeds of heroes that they are guilty of omission. The poem begins, hold on to your seatbelt. It may be a bumpy ride, but it won't hurt you. Poem begins, the nigger too should be in history. This Black man amply deserves his fame. The traitor, the spy, the coward, the renegade, the courier of favors, the lick-spittle fauna for privilege, the Judas who sold his brother for a price, looking for power, looking for gratitude, an easier place, or just not to be beaten. There follows an epic catalog of historic events and persons, a veritable archive of betrayers of Black liberation movements in the United States. The poem concludes, as the memo insists, that the betrayers of liberational efforts be exposed. Let this man have his innings in your oratory. Show how he remains a runner to the master, to the timekeeper, the warden, the straw boss, the brass hat, the top hat, the big shot, the huge noise, the power. Show him running, hat in hand, yelping, his tail and his hindquarters drooping. Listen, orator, high-collared, full-bosom-shirted, with your full-dress version of race achievement, of heroes who worked up to full-dress, too. Put this man where he belongs, in your corridor of history. Put this rat in the hole of your ship of progress, this dry rot in the rungs of your success ladder, this rampant blot on your race escutcheon, this bastard in the line of race genealogy. Celebrate this nigger. He has enough descendants to hear about his illustrious sire. A memo, of course, mandates a response. The response is mighty. Negro. An updated definition, part 368, a poem illuminating the purpose and direction of Madubuti's volume, Killing Memory, Seeking Ancestors, rejoins Brown's memo, itself a novel poetic genre, by creating yet another poetic novelty, an update. This poetic update kills the memory of a genus which would associate this rat in the hole with ever being man, genus loci. The poem sings also a mocking lyric to the tune, Born in the USA. The poem's recent context is illustrated through its dedication to a Supreme Court judge and a popular singer-actress whose identities can be discovered through the pleasures of your research, highlighting the enterprise dimension of this conference, which supplies a book stall. Moreover, the complete poem awaits your pleasure, as excerpts must suffice to obey the rule of time presentation. Negro, Negroes, and devours itself, invented around 1619 in the Americas by the British, French, Spanish, and Portuguese, also known as mulatto, Creole, buck, aborigine, quadroon, bitch, mixed blood, stud, half-breed, Uncle Ben, Uncle Mama, nigga, and whatever. Born in the USA, they was born in the USA. Negroes are treacherous and evil to own kind.
major loyalty to anything, anybody lighter than black. Born in the USA, possessor of designer jeans, license plates and mines, Negroes have been bought and sold around the world with minimum resistance. Negroes live beyond their means and enjoy socializing with people that don't like them. Great gossipers and soap opera enthusiasts, many run and jog from the word racism. Politics gives them headaches, and African history is about as important as country music. Most bow and say sir to anything wearing a tie and will die for country and General Motors. Born in the USA, Negroes live mainly in England, France, the Caribbean, United States, Brazil, and other places where Europeans built churches, planted potatoes, and put up barbed wire. Negroes were reborn in such TV shows as Webster, Give Me a Break, The Jeffersons, Different Strokes, Benson, Amen, and Miami Vice. They love money more than self, love money more than self. Negroes wake up and go to sleep praying. Thank God for slavery. Born in the USA. Nigger, Negroes, and all such curious impositions upon humanity, as an earlier ancestor, Olaudah Equiano, had phrased it, were killed, deconstructed in the first project of a massive cultural movement engaging literature, music, dance, sculpture, painting, textiles, business, philosophy, and theology. For as Don Haki pronounced it, into the 60s, a word was born. Black! And it set in motion, said forebear Gwendolyn Brooks, as you have heard beautifully at this point, a quarrel. This conference convenes to re-examine that quarrel as it issues from the question succinctly phrased by the late and herself groundbreaking poet Gwendolyn Brooks in her introduction to Don L. Lee's third published collection of poems, Don't Cry, Scream, 1969. Entitled A Further Pioneer, the introduction in its first now famous sentence situates its subject, reading, at the hub of the new word way is Don Lee. The question posed by the senior poet evolves on one hand from such poetic genres as proceed from innovative verse forms perfected by Lee and his peerage. One of these is the sketch verse. In Black Sketches, included in the Scream collection, a speaker uttering five lines, 12 words, the first line rhyming with the last, tells us that in 1963, I became black, and everyone thought it unusual, even me. While as an anticipatory gloss, a poem called In a Period of Growth, a sketch included in the first Lee collection, Think Black, by 1969 in its third edition, 12th printing, a speaker in 11 lines, 44 words, the third line in jamming the last raps, like if he had a called me black 7 years ago, I would have broke his right eye out, jumped in his chest, talked about his mama, lied on his sister and dared him to say it again all in one breath 7 years ago. These 7 years enter into American history and the history of the world an unmitigated violence aimed to kill a dream and murder a direction. They also enter a world engendering birth. The poetry of Think Black, Black Pride and Don't Cry, Scream, sketch the in-the-head shift which displaces the Du Boisian double consciousness by the nativity of a resolved black consciousness sustained in the theoretic poetic practice of Don Haki and his peerage in the latter half of the 20th century. It is a practice which infuses to measure and assess creative production globally at millennium. Yet this resolved identity and the practice it engendered then and now confronts a prevailing worldview blind to or denying or resisting and or stigmatizing its existence. That worldview is portrayed briefly, 12 lines, 27 words to percussion beat, in an intro poem, the genre by which Don Lee inaugurates his Think Black collection. America calling, Negroes, can you dance, play foot, baseball, nanny, cook, needed now, Negroes who can entertain only others not wanted and are considered extremely dangerous. These poems requiring the close reading that this conference calls for nevertheless stand in the face of an aesthetic paradigm prevailing in the academy, having entered 20 years before their advent. That paradigm poses the literary work of art as a self-contained, self-referential object. It supposes poetry to be a sui generis act of language and relies for its examples on forms and purposes evolving from ancient Greece as they move westward, as though on a single vessel whose final port of call is Ellis Island. The poetry of Don L. Lee becoming Haki Madhubuti in itself, along with an outpouring that defines a pivotal aesthetic and philosophical event in America during the latter half of the 20th century and conveying millennial studies today, constitutes the ongoing quarrel that yet requires volumes of scholarly investigation. Gwendolyn Brooks framed the question, framed the quarrel as her question. Can poetry be black? You've heard it. Isn't all poetry just poetry? The quarrel, which these questions prompted, persists today to fuel critical propositions and perspectives whose terms, essentialism and universality, are yet perceived as binaries. On the other hand, for the black arts theorist, who is Haki Madhubuti, it is legend that the nation starred in the family. Rarely can reception theory point to a response more demonstrative than that answering the call to consciousness evoked by what the venerable Howard University professor Arthur Paul Davis called the present-day black literary revolution. This naming occurs in his foreword to Marlene Moshe's applaudable critical appraisal entitled New Directions from Don L. Lee, 1975. The Davis foreword points to Lee's significance as poet, critic, social essayist, and educational writer, commanding early in his career, when the poet is only 35 or younger, a scholarly analysis that glosses with fine particularity what Gwendolyn Brooks had called the new word way. After all, the poet at the hub of the new wordway had written into prosody yet another genre that may be called the challenge poem. His poem, entitled A Poem to Complement Other Poems, all at once cinches the identity, purpose, and direction of the black literary revolution, hurls its challenge, and drums the beat of global desire. Change. Nobody can read this poem like him. But I practice it in the mirror, I'm gonna cry, I'm gonna start to do it, I'll try to stop, change life. If you were a match, I would light you into something beautiful. Change, change for the better into a real, real together thing. Change from a make-believe nothing on cornmeal and water. Change, change from the last drop to the first. Maxwell House did. Change, change was a programmer for IBM. Thought it was a brown computer. Change. Colored is something written on southern houses. Change. Greyhound did. I mean, they got restrooms on buses. Change. Change, nigga. Saw a nigga hippie. Him wanted to be different. Change. Saw a nigga liberal. Him wanted to be different. Change. Saw a nigga conservative. Him wanted to be different. Change. Niggas, don't you know that niggas are different? Change. Change. Stop being an instant yes machine. Change. Niggas don't change. They just grow. That's a change. Bigger and better niggas. Change into a necessary black self. Know the real enemy. Change. Change, nigga. Standing on the corner. Thought him was cool. Him still standing there. It's wintertime. Him cool. Change. know the real enemy changed him, wanted to be a TV star. Him is. 10 o'clock news, wanted one, nigga stole some lemon and lime popsicles, thought them was diamonds. Change, nigga change, know the real enemy changes. Is you is or is you ain't change. Change for the better, change, read a change, live a change, read a black poem, change, be the real people, change, black poems will change. Know the real enemy, the world's enemy, know them to change, 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 change your mind, nigga. Woo! Woo! The change that followed the atmospheric prevalence of this quintessential but far from singular challenge poem was mighty. Change, not yet widely entered into the history of the American Academy, is the impact of the 1967 student manifesto presented to administration and faculty at the University of California at Berkeley. Thereafter entered the weight of studies, founding curricular propositions underlining the emergent black studies. At Cornell University, Strait Hall became the dais upon which students presented their assessment of university academic deficiency. Thereafter, the African Studies and Research Center, under the direction of founder James Turner, was established. At Howard, students captured the Mordecai Wyatt Johnson Administration Building at the acme of the quadrangle. Thereafter, the capstone became the milestone of the Department of African American Studies. From the Atlanta University complex to the Delta home of Jackson State University, Tougaloo, LSU, and wider, up Route 66, connected with Interstate 85 and 95, straight up to the banks of the Hudson, where Queens College looks from the Long Island Sound at Ellis Island and from the back door of its campus trailing the Great White Way eastward to Cambridge and New Haven. Change travel to shake loose the positivism of the American Academy, experiencing the first wave that detonated its two founding and colonial projects, the Enlightenment and the education of citizens for the nation state. Change, the atmosphere created by and prompting thought and creative practice, defines the profound transgressive intervention that remains the black arts movement. The penultimate poem of Don't Cry, Scream takes the pulse, drums the motion, vibrant of a period unparalleled in recent literary history. Move on in, take over, take over, overtake, take over, take over, overtake, take over. Black people are moving to return this earth to the hands of human beings. This poem inscribes what recent literary histories do not, theories thus developing subsequently now patent in the academy, such as reception or reader response theory, are completely bereft of their greatest triumph. Practice takes place without presupposing itself as an example of some more or less powerful theory, says a millennial critic who, when asked her assessment of the role of the intellectual and political struggles going on in France during 1968, replied, "I would say that Berkeley 1967 makes more sense to me." They heard the laugh and wonder, uncomfortable, unadmitting a deeper terror. The strong men keep a coming on, getting stronger. And the women, Lord a mercy, strong. Change, another of the most frequently used words in the 2 million word production of Don L. Lee, Haki Madhubuti, occurs 500,000 times. If this count is outrageously inaccurate, no scholarship exists which proves it wrong. In calling for a scholarship that supplies a prosodic analysis of this poet's verse, its rhythms, meters, stanzas, themes, their identity, purpose, and direction, this conference calls also and foremost for an empirically realized infrastructure for the study of Black poetry. At Millennium, there exists no concordance, no index, no cross-reference guide, no dictionary of usage for the study of even one Black author writing in the United States or over the world. And yet, the path has been cleared. By 1970, senior poet and professor, the late Margaret Walker Alexander, in an address published in American libraries entitled The Humanistic Tradition of Afro-American Literature, points to a heritage developing from the ancient Oriental world in Black Africa, in Egypt, some 3,500 years ago with the Colin text on pyramids and the Book of the Dead, a heritage informing the literature of Black people, like all people, that grew out of the cosmogony and cosmology that developed around the Nile River, and not from Greece and Rome at the end of the ancient world, nor in the Middle Ages with the European Renaissance that grew out of the Renaissance already dead in Asia and Africa. That's Margaret Walker, not me. How are we to test this theory or its further observation that Black poetry may sometimes be of necessity Anglo-Saxon or Anglo-American in form, but never in content, in tone, or in philosophy? And always it is permeated with ideas of revolt against artifice, sterility, a contrived morality, and pseudo-natural ethics. How? Except by extending the project of prosodic analysis exemplified by Don L. Lee's Dynamite Voices, 1971, where, emulating the procedure of forebears like Professor Alain Leroy Locke, Sterling Brown, et al., Arthur Paul Davis, poet Langston Hughes, librarian Honor Bontemps, and contemporaries Leroy Jones and Larry Neal, he enters into literary history the poets of his time and begins prosodic analysis of their work in the light of its identity, purpose, and direction. Following Dynamite Voices, he published a capsule course in Black poetry writing, 1975, with Gwendolyn Brooks and Defining Broadside Press editor Dudley Randall, who, with predominant editor of the period, Hoyt W. Fuller, published The Black Arts Movement. These works initiated a practice fulfilled to date only by Howard University professor, the late Stephen E. Henderson, in understanding the new Black poetry. Henderson's paradigm establishing Black music as the substructure of Black poetic, if extended, allows us to hear the music of Oriki, Mutimi, Rajas, Kefs, Sabas, Dowels, Analects, Proverbs, Parables, Praise Songs, and inscribed oral epics moving from eastward and singing in the poetry of the New Word Wave. How the presence of these in contemporary and earlier Black poetry conveys the comparative literature project or examines the multicultural poetic enterprise are questions yet to be raised in assessments of recent literary history. Prosodic glosses would face down theories which account for Black poetry, Black literature, as in the main a parodic mediation representing a conversation between the proverbial monkey and the proverbial buzzard, whose end is straighten up and fly right. Though that is true, such theories blind us to an encyclopedic vocabulary of enunciation which changes the terms of the conversation, like the undauntable young Riley changes uninhabitable street signs in the fearless young Aaron Magruder's The Boondock. Riley just blots out the street sign, Bubbling Brook Meadow, and changes it to Biggie Smalls Avenue or something. And that vocabulary has prompted directions in global literature inspired by its assumptions. Meanwhile, the poetry of We Walk the Way of the New World, Book of Life, and Groundwork await full dress gloss. Change. It is unrealistic to talk about change if you are not moving to control the instruments of change in your community, writes Haki Madhubuti, from his philosophic design for pedagogy from planet to planet, life studies, the need for African minds and institutions, 1973. From this planet, he raises the question, where are the black educators who are educated blackly? The question forces self-revelation. What emerges is the portrait of an educated blackly through what he calls a few examples, a more than 600-item functional reading list of black thought diaspora-wide. This bibliography calls to attention scholars by whom Don Haki was educated blackly. The rubrics under which they are listed include government, economics, foreign affairs, psychology and sociology, education and politics, world politics and struggle, culture, Africans in America, colonialism, African historical movements, African struggles and nationalism, the Caribbean, nutrition and foods, biography and autobiography, for starters. From planet to planet to claiming earth to black men obsolete, single dangerous, the African-American family and tradition, through his latest Tough Notes, a healing call for creating exceptional black men, 2002, Haki Madhubuti has situated the context from which his question proceeds. As former Howard University professor, where he drafted his now famous worldview syllabus, a guide to study from which his work still develops, he has also written an epic roll call, naming the ancestral professoriate at Howard, who have compelled that work and to which he has called a generation. Or, as Howard University graduate students put it, and graduate students are the smartest people in the world, of course, black literature in America, which grew out of the traditions of Africa, not only serves as an inquiry into black culture, but also as a conveyor, a vessel, that carries the ancestor from one generation to the next. I'm quoting from a paper, I didn't say it. In 1973, when From Planet to Planet appeared, it addressed a worldview prevailing even after the massive movement to black studies in the 1960s. The poet observed, some black people believe that we were the first people to fly and that we came here first class. In 2003, a strange occurrence is upon us. Theory has overtaken practice. While graduate students are convinced of a black aesthetic which challenges the backwardness of status quo and grounds all subsequent post-word propositions that claim dissent on behalf of misrepresented and disadvantaged peoples the world over, and while a progressive black ministry calls for a liberational hermeneutic, in the manner of Howard University's professor, Dr. Kane Hope Felder, and while brave students surrounding monuments of power withstand below zero weather to chant, sorry state, sorry, sorry state, sorry state of the Union. Still, the poet writes, too many of our young are dying. Black children on the streets of the mega capital kill themselves in quiet or loud desperation. They are seeking sunshine from us immediately. Practice, like the practice at work in the Institute for Positive Education and the New Concept School for Primary Grades founded by Haki and Safisha Madhubuti, must pervade. Practice, like the practice at work in enterprise that values enabling product before even an ungreedy profit, must be supported. And black must be understood to mean an identity, purpose, and direction, a commitment, a practice, by which skin may be either unreliable narrator or bearer, bringer of the dark genius of ancestry. I thank the brilliant preceding panels that have revealed to us a paradigm for enterprise and the strategies of a poetry which have liberated poetic voices. I thank the forthcoming panel which will outline the terms of an available millennial philosophy. I thank the young now poets with us today who write by its sign. I thank you for your participatory love, a word used three times a page by this poet, philosopher, businessman, who yet stands at the hub of the new word wave.
Well, obviously, I'm overwhelmed by the generosity of the spirit that has generated this entire day. I appreciate all of you for coming out. And yesterday before Safisha and I journeyed here, I was really kind of, I asked Safisha, I wonder if anybody's going to show up. Yeah, I did, man, I tell you. Not that Dr. Traylor had not done, and her staff and the faculty had not done their work, but, you know, I don't take any of this for granted. I guess that's the best way to put it.